Good morning and welcome to the 8th meeting of 2022 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business is a decision to take items 3 and 4 in private. Are members content with that? Thank you. So our next item of business is an evidence session with the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Economy on the Scottish Government's National Strategy for Economic Transformation, which was published on the 1st of March. So I welcome Kate Forbes, Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Economy, who is joined by Colin Cook, Director of Economic Development, Gary Gillespie, Chief Economist, and Adam Reid, Deputy Director for Skills and the Scottish Government. I would ask members and witnesses to keep questions and answers short, and I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement.
Thanks very much, Convener, and I'll take that on board and keep my opening remarks fairly short. As you said, the National Strategy for Economic Transformation was published earlier this month, and it sets out what we want to achieve as a country. We want a strong economy that outperforms the last decade, that builds on our strengths, but also recognises some of our weaknesses. Now, some of those weaknesses are short-term in terms of the emergence of the economy from COVID, but some of them are longer-term, and the strategy doesn't shy away from that and uses quite extensive detailed analysis, consultation and input from the Council, the Advisory Council that we established to develop 5 programmes of action. And whilst the document that's been published, as it were, is the front end of the strategy in terms of the actions, I'd also encourage members to engage with the analytics paper, which is a lot more lengthy and more detailed when it comes to the data that underpins those actions. The 5 programmes of action are about our citizens, entrepreneurial people and culture. It's about the economic opportunities that are emerging, new market opportunities, particularly around net zero. It's about the need to be more productive, our businesses and our regions. And then lastly, it's about what will enable this, the skilled workforce, and what we want to achieve, which is a fairer and more equal society. I know that ultimately you will judge me, the country will judge me, and the government, on our ability to actually deliver what we've set out. So there is a 6th programme which is hugely important, which focuses on delivery and introducing a new streamlined model to maximise our success. And I know that's been an issue of interest for the committee on a number of different occasions that I've been in front of the committee. So, Convener, that's probably all I have to say at the outset. I could obviously go into detail about some of the challenges I think we face, not least since the strategy was published. The situation in Europe has got worse, and that clearly will have an economic impact. And so my last comment on this strategy is that publishing a 10-year strategy when none of us have a crystal ball is a challenge. So it has to be flexible enough and high level enough to be able to adapt to emerging situations, but it also has to be focused enough in terms of what the routes to success are. And I hope that we've achieved that balance of being flexible and sort of focused on the macro level, as well as being focused on those key vehicles of success. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. You have mentioned a number of areas that the committee members will wish to explore, not least the changed context the document has been published within. There has been some questions raised about whether the recognition is a high-level document, that it's not clear what is different in this economic strategy to previous economic strategies. And we know that there are significant issues with Scotland's economy. What is new and what is different that will mean this strategy will deliver on the priorities that you've identified?
Thanks. And interestingly, that was one of the questions that I posed to the various advisory council members and a lot of people that we consulted with. What is it you need to see in order to deliver a step change? And by and large, the strong feedback that we heard was that we know what to do. I'm sure the committee and government are probably fairly aligned on what we need to do when it comes to the Scottish economy. What we need to improve, though, is our ability to get it done and our ability to be focused, to be determined and to be ruthless in our execution of the strategy over the next 10 years. Looking at international models, international examples of government-led national strategies, what so often sets out the successful ones from the unsuccessful is that there is actually consensus across political parties, across Parliament and across government about what needs to be done. So irrespective of the challenges that emerge, those governments are able to deliver, because whoever's in administration, they know what needs to be done. So I think one thing that does set this strategy out quite considerably is a very ruthless focus on delivery. Now, that will never grab a headline. Focus on delivery will never grab the headline. There's a lot of in this document, I think, that is headline grabbing, particularly around entrepreneurship. But that focus on execution of what we need to do and streamlining our ability to do it would be a key focus. There is one smaller area that is equally important, but that I would refer to, and that is the new opportunities that have emerged. So when the last strategy was published in 2015, we knew that Scotland had great strengths when it came to our natural assets around energy. But in the last few weeks, we have seen the announcement of the world's largest floating offshore wind technology anywhere in the world. And that's remarkable. But it will only be remarkable if we're able to develop the supply chain that accompanies that, seeing businesses established. And so these opportunities, which are massive, momentous opportunities recognised the world over, are new, and the strategy sets out in detail how we will make the most of those opportunities and basically build businesses and deliver jobs over the next 10 years.
There has been a response that, I'd mentioned Fraser of Allender as well, other organisations that do have concerns that there's not enough detail, there's not enough clarity, there's not enough direction. How important are that delivery plans haven't been published? They won't be published in another 6 months yet. Why were they not published with the original document? And is it, that vacuum's been created? Will the delivery plans fill that?
I think they will. And again, I'd refer you to the two documents that have been published, the analytics paper, which is quite a weighty document, and then also the sort of easier to read document, which is the emerging actions. Because we were committing to publishing this document as quickly as possible after the election, and obviously there was some delay with the emergence of Omicron over the winter period, but because we were committed to delivering that as quickly as possible, and also because the agents of delivery are not all within government. So unlike if you take the health service, for example, the NHS reports directly, it is all in its entirety within the public sector. If you take economic growth, let's say 70% of the agents of delivery are the private sector. So we absolutely need businesses to be on board. We need entrepreneurs to be on board. We need academics to be on board. And they need to play their part in the delivery and the implementation. So you'll see in the document where we have detailed next to each of the actions who we think owns it. But in order to deliver an implementation plan, we really need to work with them to do that. So we believed it was more important to publish the high-level actions and then work with them on the implementation plan.
Okay, thank you. I'll bring in Jamie Harcourt-Johnson.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. The Convener's covered the views of the Fraser of Allender Institute, but there has been a number of other organisations raised concerns, and some pretty eminent people too. I raised with you in the Chamber the response of Ronald MacDonald. This report provides a widely known and understood diagnosis of the problems facing the Scottish economy, but on solutions it is simply a rehash of all the failed scripts we've seen since 2007. The kind of substantive issues we need to discuss are simply not there. So you've talked about, obviously, the strategy, your hopes for the strategy and delivery. Can you tell us how you will measure that delivery and how you will keep us updated on where the delivery, the strategy is in terms of delivery?
Thanks. And let me take those two questions in turn, because the second question was about measurement and the first question was around solutions. Perhaps I could take advantage of the opportunity to say that I'm pleased that Ronald MacDonald agrees that we've diagnosed the problem, because that in itself is the first start. And again, I'd go back to saying that it's easy to shy away from diagnosing the problem, the long-term structural challenges and some of the short-term post-COVID challenges. In terms of the solutions, there is a lot of material in this document which is new. I've already referred to some examples when it comes to developing a more robust supply chain, a Scotland-based supply chain for our renewables. I mean, I'm sure you would be one of the first in the chamber to criticise the government for not having done enough to develop the supply chain for the renewables. So the fact that we've set out a comprehensive plan for how we're going to do that and a commitment to do that, to my mind, sounds like it's new. So I think it's unfair to suggest that there are no new solutions. What we've done is start with the data, diagnose the problem and identify the actions to get there, bearing in mind that not all the agency lies with government. A lot of the agency lies with other institutions and with the private sector as well. In terms of the measurement, this is vital, because if we're not measuring the right things, then we are probably not going to be able to define what success looks like. And ultimately, certainly in the implementation plan, there will be clear metrics for success. But again, I'd go back to the analytics paper in terms of what we're measuring. If I give you an example of entrepreneurship, Scotland is an entrepreneurial country. If you define it in terms of, for example, entrepreneurial activity, startups, new businesses. But where we are not performing like we should is when it comes to scale-ups. So in other words, the success rate for new businesses is not as high as it should be. So there's much to celebrate in the way of entrepreneurial activity. If you just stopped there, you could say that's been a success. But actually, in terms of business survival rates, there's a problem, and we don't perform in the same way that Ireland performs and so on. So I think what you measure is key, and we'll set out those measurements. And that is unpacked in the analytics paper, particularly the example around entrepreneurship. Convener, I don't know if Gary Gillespie, Chief Economist, would like to come in on this point on measurement, because it was an issue that we debated at length around what is it that we should measure.
Mr. Gillespie, please do come in if you wish to.
Okay, thanks very much. So I think just to add to what the Cabinet Secretary said around measurement, you'll see in the analytical paper quite a detailed analysis of all of the five programmes, the underlying data. And in that context, at the Advisory Council, there's quite a lot of discussion about what are we trying to achieve across each of these objectives, which are different in each domain. So what you'll see, I suppose, across the 18 projects, 77 actions, some of the actions are continuing actions, some of them are new, some have existing governance, some have data in place at the moment. For those that don't have data, we are looking at how best to measure both the direct action in terms of its impact on the ground, but also its wider interaction. And you'll see in the analytical paper also we published some illustrative modelling of the types of impact the strategy could have, just focusing on our export performance, a small increase in real wages and productivity, and you can see the impact over a 10-year period can be quite profound. Now, as the Cabinet Secretary said at the outset, we can't essentially over a 10-year period, you can't model everything. The strategy is truly transformational in the sense that a lot of the new market areas we will see develop, and we can't model in entirety the final solutions across those. But in terms of the metrics, we have a clear grasp of all the metrics in those areas. We've already done modelling on that. And in the work around delivery in the programme with the enterprise agencies and others, we're essentially tying down what the metrics will be, both for the action being in place, how we'll report progress on that, and what it will ultimately mean to our key metrics in the economy, which is set out in the document. Thanks.
One more question.
Yeah, thanks very much for that. I mean, I suppose, firstly, I would say, and I don't want to put words into Professor McDonald's mouth, but I think what he was suggesting is that you haven't diagnosed the problem. They've been well known within the economic sector, and at last there seems to be a recognition within government that these are some of the issues that are there to be delivered on. One issue that the Fraser Vallander also raised, that even if these measures are hit, that they had concerns about whether that will lead to the successes or the plan succeeding as you believe it will do. So I suppose, is that a concern for you? I mean, I appreciate you talked about we can't read the future, but you know, even if the objections or the ambitions of the plan are met in terms of deliverables, that might not lead to the success that you wanted. Is that a concern?
So I think, again, taking that question in two parts, I think if we have a streamlined, focused delivery landscape, then in a sense that vehicle will drive itself. So if we have a very focused approach from our enterprise agencies and so on what we're trying to achieve, which is the new market opportunities, more entrepreneurial culture and citizens, and a focus on productivity. Again, if you look internationally, these are three ingredients for success. And that is not aligned with a particular circumstance, that is not aligned with only being relevant in the immediate post-COVID phase. Those things will be relevant going forward, and they've certainly been the foundation stones for Scottish economic success to date. So I think there's an element there around delivery. But in terms of the other point, we do need to be flexible and agile enough to respond. So when it comes to productivity across our regions, I want to see the Highlands, Ayrshire, Glasgow, Edinburgh, North East being as productive as possible. And that will remain a focus irrespective of what the circumstances are. So nothing is inevitable. Success is never inevitable. I mean, in no country and no planet is success inevitable unless you go out and seek it. What the strategy is built on is the fact that Scotland has advantages and strengths that are the envy of many other countries. Let's build on them and let's make sure we're as successful as possible.
Okay.
Maggie Chapman to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks very much, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you for your opening remarks. I suppose following on a little bit from Jamie's question on measurement, I'm interested in exploring two areas. One is around the indicators of progress, I suppose, and measurement feeds into that, obviously. The Inclusive Development Index is welcome, but how can we take this further to measure intrinsic environmental well-being, and I suppose, importantly, also include within that the benefits of a care economy that doesn't really... is kind of implicit in the document, but doesn't come out as a significant single thing itself.
It's a great two questions. Just on the first one of the actions is, of course, to develop a well-being economy monitor. So that will bring measures into measurement, like healthy life expectancy, fair work indicators, mental well-being, child poverty, greenhouse gas emissions and biodiversity. And again, it goes back to the question that was previously asked and to which I responded. The measurements are key. So what we measure really matters. And we've obviously been one of the founding governments when it comes to the Wellbeing Governments Initiative, working with countries like New Zealand to improve our measurement of well-being, because we talk about trying to build a well-being economy, but the measurement of it is really important. Some of the elements in that will align, obviously, with other metrics that we already work to. So around biodiversity, obviously greenhouse gas emissions, child poverty, we have metrics in place. And the point here is to ensure that our economic activity is contributing to them, certainly not undermining them, but more than that, contributing to them. In terms of your second question around care, I think on care, as you say, that the strategy is a fairly short document. We could have taken an approach which might have been quite popular, which was to try and go through and list everything that we think that people would like to see as name checking. But on care, there's reference to the importance of care in achieving all of our economic aims. It's an economic strategy, it's not a care strategy. But for example, if you take, going back to my favourite subject, which is entrepreneurship, and the fact that there is still underrepresentation of certain groups. And the strategy specifically says, well, in order to provide those underrepresented groups with more exposure to entrepreneurship, more exposure to mentorship, more encouragement and support to build a business and so on, we need to understand what's stopping them. And if you take women, for example, and obviously it's not just women that have caring responsibilities by any means, but if it's women, then that will probably mean an enhanced wraparound care support. Or where individuals have caring responsibilities, how do we ensure that there's a wraparound support there to help them with their caring responsibilities? So I guess identifies that if we're serious about supporting those with caring responsibilities, either in a paid capacity or unpaid capacity, we need to do more as a government to provide that wraparound care. That sits alongside a lot of other things that are going on in terms of National Care Service and improving terms and conditions and pay for our carers. But that's where it's referenced in this strategy.
Thanks for that. I suppose I see the care economy as being more than just enabling people, giving people the care they need so they can go out to work. I think it's much, much more than that. But I take your point that it's part of a much wider thing and that it connects to other things. I suppose in terms of opportunities, and we've had conversations before about some of the, it's really good to see things like renewable energy, heating buildings, decarbonised transport, all of that as highlighted opportunities. But I suppose the question, how will constrained public funding be structured to enable action in these plans and to enable the delivery that you've spoken about?
Yeah, it's a critical question. And it goes back to two points, really. One is that we are obviously halfway through our resource spending review, so setting out multi-year budgets. So the strategy reflects and recognises the fact that we do need multi-year budgeting for this to be successful. So that's the bottom line. So the resource spending review is due to be published in the coming months, and that will set out long-term or a medium-term trajectory rather on spending. But specifically on the opportunities around new markets, that's where we absolutely have to leverage in private sector funding. There's no question about that. I mean, it is well documented that the gap between what we need to achieve, for example, to meet net zero, and what we have funding to be able to do is quite significant. Now, the bottom line is that funding is out there. You know, there's $130 trillion of assets under management right now that have been identified as part of the GFANS initiative that needs to find a home. It will either find a home in Scotland or it will find a home elsewhere. I want it to find a home in Scotland. But to find a home in Scotland, we need two things. One, we need to be clear about the prospectus, the green prospectus. And obviously we've built the £3 billion green prospectus, which we used extensively at COP26. We need to expand on that, I think, and bring in more initiatives so that investors can easily find opportunities. And those opportunities need to align with our values as well. So that's an important point. But the second thing is, I go back to the supply chain, that as a result of the potentially up to 25 gigawatts of offshore wind energy that might be developed over the next 10 years, as part of that, we're facing a choice. We're either going to create jobs out with Scotland or create jobs in Scotland. And the way to create jobs in Scotland is to see businesses being established, businesses growing, and businesses identifying and taking a larger share of that market. And, you know, I'd refer you to Project 5 under New Market Opportunities, which explicitly says, build on Scotland's strengths to win an ever greater share of domestic and international market opportunities. That is the action that hits that nail on the head. And I don't want to miss the opportunity.
Thank you.
Thank you. Gordon MacDonald, to be followed by Colin Smith.
Thanks so much, Convener, and morning, Cabinet Secretary. You touched upon productivity, and I was wanting to ask you a few questions on that area. The University of Glasgow's Productivity Institute report published in December highlighted that Scotland's productivity growth has outperformed all regions of the UK over the 1999-2019 period. However, our productivity is still below the UK average. So what are the challenges Scotland faces in continuing to improve its productivity?
Yeah, and it's good to reference that growth in productivity over the last 10 years in particular. And it is an issue, of course, that a lot of countries, developed countries, are grappling with just now. What we identify in the paper, and again, there's more analysis in the analytics paper, what we identify is a mixture of business investment and the need to improve business productivity. So that includes investment opportunities specifically. It includes areas like increased digitalisation. So we know, for example, that there are more businesses who have access to, let's take, for example, superfast broadband, than are actually perhaps using it to its full extent. So business investment, digitalisation, and then workforce. So ensuring that our workers have the skills that they need to be as productive as possible. And productivity, quite clearly, is one of the most important metrics, really, for not just improved economic performance, but actually for well-being, because it drives up wages, it improves work-life balance, and ultimately positions Scotland internationally. So that's on the private sector side. On the public sector side, obviously we have a role when it comes to improving infrastructure. So we've set out, obviously, the strategic transport review and the projects review that's under consultation just now, but making sure that we're investing in the right infrastructure to improve productivity as well. So I think that would be my quick summary of what we're talking about. We do have one other part to our actions, which I'm hugely supportive of, and it's this notion that improving national productivity whilst leaving parts of the country behind is not a mark of success. So actually what we need to do is identify the building blocks and try and work with every region in Scotland to improve regional productivity, which will then contribute to national productivity. So there's a big focus here on not forgetting any part of the country or leaving any part of the country behind. And some regions are, in terms of, you know, the measurement right now, are coming across as more productive, and it's due to the skills mix, it's due to the industry mix. So we need to work with those parts of the country that need additional government investment and support from business.
That was actually going to be my next question, is how we supported those areas that aren't doing as well as the likes of Edinburgh or Stirling or Aberdeen, for that matter. So in terms of productivity growth, Scotland has 8 industrial sectors that outperform the UK average, such as energy and finance. And I was going to ask, what steps will this strategy take in order that other companies and sectors can learn and understand how business can drive productivity improvements?
Yeah, so there is a point here around businesses working with business. So one of the actions that we've committed to is appointing productivity ambassadors. There's obviously been talk about productivity commissioners in the past, so productivity ambassadors. And their job will be to work intensively with key industries to drive productivity improvements. And as part of that, work on an international basis. So build international networks, work with similar industries in other parts of the world to learn, you know, what are the key investments that need to be made, perhaps around technology, perhaps around workforce, to improve productivity and ensure that there is a particular focus on leadership in these industries for improving productivity. So as you see, there are some industries that are far and away, significantly more productive than others. I think we need to work with them, not just to be content that they are more productive than others, but actually that they are world leading when it comes to productivity, because many of them are competing on an international stage, not on a domestic stage. But then also work with other industries, which are well known, so I won't rehearse or list them, but work with other industries where there does need to be more investment in reskilling, upskilling, digital technology, innovation, to bring them higher.
OK, thanks very much, Convener.
Thank you. Colin Smith, to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. The STUC have branded the strategy a missed opportunity to deliver transformative change. That they say there's not enough focus on improving paying conditions in the foundational economy, which is obviously the largest employer and an engine room of economic activity. Ros Foye, who's part of the Advisory Council you referred to, said this is more a strategy for economic status quo than economic transformation. Why do you think the STUC are wrong?
I think the STUC actually make a significant contribution to this, and I know that they're very interested in helping us with delivery. And actually, on the launch morning itself, there were at least 2 representatives from unions, including one from Unite, who referenced very specifically how pleased they were to see Fair Work built in to so much of the strategy's work. So, you know, the programmes of action that we have chosen are based on evidence, but we recognise that economic growth, economic prosperity is for a purpose, and that purpose is to ensure that we have a fairer and more equal society. So there's some pretty sort of pioneering initiatives from a Scottish perspective in here, not least building conditionality into support for business, ensuring that we are focused very much on underrepresented groups, and that we ensure greater payment of the real living wage across our economy. So these are all in line with the STUC's requirements. We are committed to developing sectoral fair work agreements with industry, and we're committed to working with trade unions. So actually, in terms of what the STUC and others have looked for in the ways of fair work and greater equality, I think there's a lot in this strategy that will deliver that.
Clearly, when the Scottish General Secretary of STUC says it's a strategy for economic status quo and not economic transformation, there must be things missing from that strategy.
Yes, it's missing.
Well, I think we should go a lot further in terms of conditionality around, for example, trade union access. But one of the big issues that you did mention that the trade unions are obviously deeply concerned about is around those supply chain jobs, and you highlighted the issue of offshore wind. In the past, the former First Minister Alex Salmond said that Scotland would be the Saudi Arabia of renewables. The government promised 130,000 renewable jobs. The most recent ONS figures show that that number is 20,500, and it's actually fallen. So why do you think that the government have failed to meet those targets, and what is your new target for renewable jobs if we're on the issue of focusing on delivery? What is that target?
I mean, of course, the Bank of Scotland and PwC would disagree with you, because both of them have referenced Scotland as leading the way when it comes to the creation of green jobs, and certainly on a UK-wide basis, that the greatest opportunities for the green economy are already here in Scotland. That's not wishful thinking for the future. That is the present. Our commitment that comes through the strategy Loud and Clear is a commitment to a just transition. In other words, there are great economic opportunities emerging, and I've already referenced some of them in terms of ScotWind, but we need to do this in a fair way. And I think we have gone a significant distance on conditionality, with a commitment to embedding conditionality by this summer. We also referenced the importance of, as I said, sectoral agreements, and we also referenced the importance of trade union recognition. So I think on these points, these are going to ensure that that transition and the significant economic opportunities are underpinned by a fair work approach. But we also have Adam Reid, who may want to come in, if you don't mind, on fair work. Although he's on mute.
Secretary, Cabinet Secretary, as you said, you know, the plan is really clear about applying fair work and conditionality, including really effective channels for worker voice, and we'll be taking that forward as part of delivery of the plan, and we can set out more details for the committee if that would be helpful.
The issue on renewable jobs, though, you said that we're leading the way, but your government promised 130,000 renewable jobs by 2020. The ONS figures show that number is a sixth of that level, and it's fallen. So I'm keen to know why you think we're leading the way if we are so far behind what your government's target was for renewable jobs. It's a big concern around supply chain jobs for the trade unions. And what is your new target for renewable jobs if the 130,000 target is so far off the mark in terms of delivery?
So, again, I was quoting two independent analysts. So I'd perhaps suggest...
Target, though. I would like to know why you failed to meet
it. In terms of defending the Bank of Scotland and the Green Jobs Barometer that PwC publish, you obviously can consider those. In terms of green jobs, I mean, we at the moment are doing quite a lot of work internally in government in terms of trying to measure green jobs, because there are very narrow ways of measuring green jobs. But actually, there's a lot of jobs that are being established and created in a number of different industries that you could classify very much as green jobs. So, for example, I most recently met with a real estate organisation, a real estate business, which is one of the largest real estate businesses in the world, and they can reference a number of jobs that have been created, including as a result of work in Scotland, which are directly contributing to making non-domestic properties net zero. So at the moment, jobs like that are probably not captured when it comes to being classified as a green job, but they are contributing to making the country as a whole net zero. And you know, I think right now, our approach through this strategy is to say, right, where are the challenges right now? Let's meet them head on, and let's ensure that we build a more robust supply chain.
It would certainly take a leap to go from 20,500 to 130,000 just by changing the definition. But I'd be keen maybe in the future just to hear what the government's target actually is, however you define it. But one final issue, briefly, Convener. In the past, an issue that I've raised is around the cluttered landscape that businesses and organisations face when they're seeking support. So it was an issue that was highlighted by Audit Scotland. Now, you've changed the name of the Enterprise and Skills Strategic Board, and I think you've now called it the Snappy National Strategy for Economic Transformation Delivery Board, and you're obviously going to co-chair that. But if I'm a business getting on with a day job, looking to see from all the various organisations where I'm best placed to get support, how does this strategy make that less cluttered for those businesses? Because you're obviously not removing any of those organisations. So what's changed from that very cluttered landscape that businesses keep referring to?
Well, two things. Firstly, the access that businesses will have to support will change. So not only will it be more streamlined in terms of it needs to align with what our strategy says. So, for example, there will be changes to conditionality. There will be changes to the things that we are focused on. So there will be changes inevitably to the support that businesses receive. One point I would make, though, on the streamlining that is that as soon as you stop anything, I can guarantee that whether it's Colin Smith or somebody else will be posing questions to me as to why we have stopped certain schemes, certain initiatives, and so on. So inevitably, one of the byproducts of streamlining is that you bring everything into one place, and by default, there might be things that have to change. So if we believe in change, then hopefully that's something that Parliament can remember in the future when it comes to the schemes that are available, and some of those schemes will either change or will have to adapt, or will be no more because we have adapted our approach. So that's the first thing. The second thing is that there's obviously support that's provided, let's say, by the enterprise agencies. It's not specifically grant support. It's not about accessing funding. And again, the enterprise agencies will be aligning all their activity to the actions that we have set out in the strategy. So they will be aligning all their activity to the objectives in this strategy. And it will be very clear to businesses what the enterprise agencies are doing, what they're seeking to achieve, and then obviously the opportunities that come from that to get on board.
Yes, thank you. I'm going to make some progress now. Colin Smith to be followed by Alexander Burnett.
It's
Colin Beattie to be followed by Alexander Burnett.
Both the Colins are handsome people. Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, there has been some criticism that the strategy doesn't quantify the benefits that each project is expected to deliver and how this will actually link directly into the higher level ambitions and the vision for the Scottish economy in 2032. How far will the delivery plans, which are being finalised within 6 months, go to flesh out this strategy?
So the delivery plans will definitely flesh out the strategy. And as we've already said, we will ensure that there are clear metrics in that. We obviously have set out on a high level basis what we think the contribution will be to the Scottish economy over the next 10 years. But as Gary Gillespie said just a few moments ago, there are some areas that are just by their nature more difficult to measure and to define, particularly the opportunities that come around with the new markets. And we're still at a fairly early stage when it comes to doing that. There are some things that are easier to model, in other words, than others. But there's certainly a grasp in the analytics paper, the 133-page analytics paper, of the overall contribution to the Scottish economy. There are areas that are easier to define than others. So, for example, when it comes to our export strategy, we will know what success looks like. When it comes to fair work, success will be building in conditionality. So there are some things that are easier to quantify than others, other things that are more challenging, and we will set out that the metrics in the implementation strategy.
Thank you. There's just a slightly different question here. I think in the last day or so, I saw a figure for unemployment in Scotland being at 3.8%. I seem to remember an economist somewhere saying that when you got to 3%, you were effectively at full employment. We have significant labour shortages in certain areas, and we have the ambitions set out in the paper we're looking at for these new startups, for expansion of IT capabilities, for increasing exports, all of which needs labour. To what extent is our inability to control our own borders in terms of immigration, have our own immigration policy, going to impact on this? Where are we going to find the labour that are going to actually carry out all these new strategies?
So this strategy is obviously unusual compared with other independent government strategies, because if you compare, and we did do some work, if you compare this strategy with pretty much any other international independent government, they have far more tools and levers at their disposal. So macro, fiscal, economic, monetary levers are all reserved. So it's quite remarkable trying to build an economic strategy when, for example, you don't have any control over migration, or when you don't have control over the vast majority of tax powers, or over some regulation, or, for example, international trade. And you're right in saying that our unemployment rate is 3.8%. It's lower than the UK's unemployment rate. So from that perspective, accessing additional labour is hugely challenging in a country which has always, I think, welcomed inward migration, and which has an outlook right now, a demographic outlook, which indicates we absolutely need to build and extend our working age population. So it's a huge, huge challenge. One of the actions, of course, in the strategy is around talent attraction from the rest of the UK. And Scotland has done very well when it comes to talent attraction from the rest of the UK to date. We just need to do even better, because right now our businesses, our industries are crying out for labour. There is an acute labour shortage, and yet we have no capacity to manage visas or in any way attract or ensure that once we've attracted individuals that there is an easy route for them to get here.
So you've highlighted a number of areas where there are constraints on what you can do because of reserved matters. Is there any prospect that, given the ambitions that we've got, that there might be areas where the UK government might support these ambitions and the vision that we have here in Scotland?
Well, I mean, I think it's slim, but it's worth trying. But I think it's very slim. If I go back a year ago or so to the Logan review, Mark Logan's review of the opportunities for the tech industry in Scotland, as an independent individual, not a politician, he set out clearly the need, for example, to have a tech visa. And in my conversations with so many industries, they talk about the need of having industry-specific visas. Now, that's not something I can grant. But in the engagement with the UK government, there has been no appetite or no willingness to consider sector-specific visa arrangements, for example, for the tech industry or otherwise. So thus far, I don't think there's been much, if any, progress. Even in industries where it's an issue that's UK-wide, I don't think we've seen huge progress. And certainly right now, The reflection on the current discourse around refugees and migration suggests to me that we have a long way to go before making any progress.
Okay, thank you. I have to make some progress. Alexander Burnett, be followed by Fiona Hislop.
Thank you, Convener. My question will be about measurement and labour, and particularly the underrepresented groups the Cabinet Secretary referred to earlier. But can I just ask first about comments in her opening statement? You talk about now seeing how important delivery is. I'd ask why was delivery not seen as important until now? And in your answer to Jamie Halker-Johnson, you blame agency in the private sector for a lack of delivery. What responsibility lies with the Scottish Government for the lack of delivery over the last 14 years?
I think you would have to go to quite a stretch to suggest I'm blaming the private sector. And that's quite a remarkable misrepresentation of my remarks. In terms of delivery, I am not saying that delivery hasn't been a focus. What I'm saying in response to Jamie Halker-Johnson's question about what, and indeed the convener's question about what is new, is that our evidence suggested that we understand what the challenges are. The issue now is over a 10-year period, ruthlessly focusing on delivering what we know are the solutions to those challenges. So that's, as I said, not going to grab any headlines, but we know what we need to do and we need to persevere in delivering that. There are new opportunities that have also emerged, not least in Alexander Burnett's part of the country. And the question now is to ensure that we deliver on that supply chain, which is there, but needs to grow and expand to meet the opportunities of ScotWind. And quite clearly, when it comes to the supply chain, that is where we need to work with the private sector to maximise the opportunities.
Thank you. Moving on to the Labour question. Yeah, unfortunately, we have the larger economically inactive population than the UK average. I'm not sure why. I don't know if the Cabinet Secretary has an opinion, but it's obviously a historical point. More importantly, getting them into work is particularly difficult given the diversity of this group. And you mentioned underrepresented groups in the economy. So can I just ask, how do you intend to do it? What measurements will you be able to provide of this group? And most importantly, what of its subgroups? How will you be able to break down this larger group so we can actually see what's happening and how things are working or not working?
Yeah, and obviously the economic inactivity figures, which are well documented in the analytics paper, the most common reason cited for economic inactivity in Scotland is temporary or long-term health problems in the workforce. And we also have a big contingent which are in full-time study or have caring responsibilities. So understanding who, that economic inactivity phrase is a catch-all, but actually getting underneath it and understanding how we encourage those that can work into work is important. The commitment in the strategy is to try and remove more of those barriers, but also to simplify the employability system by implementing No One Left Behind. Now, it's important to say that those who are furthest from the job market will require greater and more intensive investment to bring them closer to the job market. And that is certainly a commitment that we're willing to make, but it is it does require significant upfront investment and a willingness to work intensively with individuals to bring them closer. So we've set out that commitment. We need to do it. Quite clearly, the earlier question around the need to access skills demonstrates that we need to support as many people into work as possible. But I think we need to understand what is currently preventing people from working. And for some, it goes back to my earlier answer to Maggie Chapman around caring responsibilities. For others, it's full-time study, which is good. And then there's others for whom it is ill health. So there's quite a small group in all that we need to work with to encourage them into work and provide the support that they need.
Thank you. No further questions, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you. Fiona Hislop.
Cabinet Secretary. The focus on transformation and change means that you want to do things differently. There's a focus on entrepreneurial aspects as well as trying to be streamlined and focused on delivery. So one of the areas in the entrepreneurship section is about expanding the tech-scalar model to all sectors. Now, the tech-scalar model also comes with a cost, so therefore, if it's expanded to all sectors, that will clearly mean it, that's not necessarily streamlined, it doesn't necessarily mean it's focused, but it will have a cost, which means other things may not happen unless you've got additional budget. So could you unpack some of that thinking for us?
It's a great question, and it's a theme that runs through all of our budget discussions when it comes to the economy, which is, what are we going to do, and then let's do it really well. So we've set out the fact that we believe that entrepreneurial people and culture is one of the key building blocks of economic transformation, and therefore we will prioritise it when it comes to funding and expand it, as you say. And we'll also create pre-scalar hubs too, alongside the expansion of the tech-scalar programme, so that we're actually engaging with potential high-growth businesses at a much earlier stage. That is an approach that we're committed to doing. We want to do it in partnership with the private sector too, so it will be something that we prioritise, as we've already prioritised through the implementation of the Logan Review. And you're right, inevitably that will mean there are other things that we can't do. And it goes back to my point, I suppose, to Colin Smith, that when we perhaps do stop doing certain things in order to focus on what we've set out in the strategy, there will be questions. But we've set out the blueprint here. That's what we want to deliver, and that's what we're focused on delivering. And rather than trying to do everything under the sun, let's focus on where we think we're going to make the biggest impact and really shift the dial. And that's what the strategy captures.
At some point, the committee will have to think about what is not going to be done in order to focus on this. Can I move on now to resilience and supply chains? Now, clearly, this is a 10-year transformation strategy, but we already know we're dealing and continue to deal with the consequences of Brexit, and we're still living through Brexit, we're still living through a pandemic, and indeed we know with the international security issues and the war in Ukraine, that will have economic consequences globally. So in terms of a resilient supply chain, that's more important than ever. And you focused your remarks clearly on ScotWind and the new industries and developing industries and supply chain focus for them. But surely during this 10 years, there's an important focus will remain on resilience for bread and butter, our foundational economy, as we've heard from Colin Smith, but clearly food and drink or construction or engineering or those areas. So what in the strategy would enable Scotland to build a more resilient supply chain overall to help us make sure that we've got that kind of economic security apart from anything else?
Yeah, and there is specific reference post-COVID, I guess, but specific reference to the need to build in resilience. In terms of the specific action, there is a commitment to expanding a programme that we already have, which you'll probably be well-versed in, but the Supply Chain Development Programme. And that is about improving the capacity, the capability and the development of Scottish supply chains, including targeting, identifying Scottish companies with the skills, the capacity, the capability to bid for, to win and to deliver contracts in key industries. And that's beyond just ScotWind. That's about trying to identify those businesses very intentionally and working with them, basically to improve their resilience. Some of them may already be operating within key supply chains. Others might not be and should be building their business more. So it's a more intensive way of working in terms of identifying those businesses and then working with them, rather than just waiting for the supply chain to develop its own resilience. Although I think after COVID, a lot of these supply chains are far more resilient than they were going into COVID because of the necessity of adapting.
Thank you. Just a question connected to that was about the export target that's been set by the plan. So the target is to increase by 5% to 25% by 2030. As Fiona Hislop's outlined, there are extreme pressures, whether it's COVID, we still have the hangover from Brexit, and now we have obviously the war in Ukraine is putting pressure. How are you still confident of that target, and how will the plan have to change in order to recognise the current situation that we're in?
We are still focused on that target. and we carefully monitor, as it were, the progress of the export strategy, which my colleague Ivan McKee leads on. In terms of the question around current impact on that, I don't know if any of the panel, if Gary, because Gary's team have been doing extensive work on monitoring the impact of the war in Europe on our trading arrangements, as well as on our on our resilience as an economy. So I don't know if Gary Gillespie wants to make any comment on the impact, for example, on the export target.
If Mr. Gillespie could be brief, that would be helpful.
Yeah, just very briefly. So I suppose in a sense, the earlier point around resilience supply chains, what we've seen since COVID, really, and pre-COVID, was a change in how the global system works and a shortening of supply chains, resulting initially from COVID in China, and that changing. What we're seeing with Ukraine and Russia, obviously, is supply chains being impacted primarily through continued disruption, through increased commodity prices, and obviously that feeds through into producer input prices in Scotland and wider impacts both in the cost of doing business and the cost of living. And we're also seeing through the monitoring of our exposure, both through the economic sanctions and restrictions now. If you think about it, essentially the trading world has become smaller. So Scotland, we know, exports around 245, 250 million to Russia, about around 50 million to Ukraine. Similarly, we import around 200 million from Russia and a lesser amount from Ukraine. So the impacts of those, both on our key sectors, on parts of our economy, what we'd say is those particular trade flows are relatively small in the scale of our impacts. Where our exports and imports have been more impacted, really, it's been through COVID and EU exit, both intertwining with the supply chain issues that I've mentioned in terms of constraints. So I think what you're seeing now is a greater focus on shorter supply chains. Resilience of supply chain has been one of the top risks now for businesses, both within Scotland, the UK and within Europe, and really investing in that supply chain and understanding that. I think Ms. Hislop touched on food and drink. I think that's a really good example for Scotland, where we have a really strong supply chain within Scotland, built on a lot of the natural capital that exists. And that industry in particular are really keen in understanding how resilient they are in terms of their exports and how that feeds through in that context. So in terms of the export challenge, what we know from the current situation is the impact of Ukraine, Russia is expected obviously to slow global growth this year. It will have an impact on trade, estimates around 1% fall in global growth. It will also potentially increase inflationary pressures at a global level from up to 2-3%, which again will impact on domestic production through squeezing both the cost of inputs and the cost of goods for consumers. So it's a kind of negative, obviously immediate shock, but the global economy's had a number of those shocks over recent years, and it will come back.
Thank you. Jamie Hogg-Cons, did you wish to ask a further question?
Yeah, very, very brief question on that. On the supply chain side, it's been reported that the former transport minister said that it could be 1.5 billion needed for replacement ferries. Obviously, that could be a real opportunity for a shipbuilding. But we've seen ferries and contracts going to Turkey, as you're very well aware. So how can this strategy help support our shipbuilding sector? How can it ensure that CMAL are looking at yards, not just publicly owned or government-owned yards, but other yards, and making sure that procurement processes work for them? And how can this strategy work with the UK government's refreshed shipbuilding strategy?
Yeah, no, and we've been engaging with the UK government's refreshed shipbuilding strategy in particular because of the opportunities that we know and the opportunities here in Scotland. We also recognise that from a procurement perspective, that is one of the most powerful arms that we have as a public sector, as a government, that at a time where public finances are not plentiful, as the Chancellor tightens the purse strings post-COVID, procurement is a significant opportunity. Quite clearly, when it comes to ferries, there will be opportunities within Scotland, opportunities out with Scotland in terms of developing those links. But long story short, procurement is a key arm, and it's an area that we reference alongside our spending power to create new opportunities for Scotland. And it goes right to the heart of developing a supply chain, because under Project 6, which is around the development of the Scottish supply chains in the strategy, we specifically talk about our strategic approach to public ownership, so that public companies are being managed, they're being developed, and they're being initiated for the public good. And so that goes probably to the issue that you're referencing.
Thank you. I'll bring Michelle Thompson in for a closing question.
Thank you very much. I was very interested in what yourself and Gary were saying in terms of export, and particularly the evidence of impact still to emerge. But I think perhaps inadvertently, Gary gave a very good explanation of and reminder why proximity in terms of trade is so utterly vital. And therefore, I understand that the global impacts, the geopolitics that are going on, well, we'll see them fold out. But in terms of proximity impacts, i.e. our trade with Europe, within that, have you got any more sense of the additional costs incurred by Brexit and how that will impact on developing these resilience in supply chains in numerical terms? Because obviously Brexit is still ongoing, if you like, and that's an important area when we link it to proximity. Have you got any sort of further reflections on that? Thanks.
Thanks. Certainly, and I'll prime Gary Gillespie to see if he wants to come in with additional analysis on the additional costs. Certainly, the anecdotal feedback from businesses, particularly smaller businesses, are that higher costs, increased levels of bureaucracy, have had an impact on trade. And certainly, I think it seems to be disproportionately affecting perhaps some of the smaller SMEs who had previously been able to trade in and of themselves. Some of the larger businesses are able to access these markets more easily, but it is increased cost. Now, if you go back to the questions around productivity and how we improve our productivity as an economy, one of the most significant opportunities is through increased exports. That's why our export plan is so important. That's why that target of 25% is so important. And so any additional cost when it comes to accessing one of the largest trading blocks in the world, obviously it doesn't help with that. But Gary Gillespie may have some analysis on EU exit.
Well, thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. So we're kind of looking at the analysis to try and disentangle both the impacts of EU exit alongside essentially COVID. So trying to break out how has COVID and EU exit impacted in Scotland's trade figures. And what we see from the initial modelling, the way we do this is a technique called synthetic control. And we look at a peer group of similar sized countries and basically model their impact in terms of the COVID, and then look at how they've responded relative to Scotland. And what we do pick up from the initial work is an additional impact, an additional negative impact on trade for Scotland over and above what should have been the case primarily from COVID. So that's the work that we're doing internally, and I'm happy to maybe share that work with the committee in due course once we finalise that and share more widely.
Thank you very much. And obviously, the framing out of this, I mean, I think it's been very, very brave to do a 10-year macro strategy like this. I regard it as a framework strategy and have, of course, read the 118 pages of analysis underneath it. And in terms of other important areas, the section around, which is of personal interest to me, are financial services and fintech sectors, including Scotland's leading positions in responsible and ethical finance. I'm on the record for being fairly active in this area and highlighting where lax governance has allowed for pretty extensive corruption in the UK, and very conservative figures put that at £290 billion each and every year, or 15% of UK GDP, which is utterly shocking. Now, my concern is that the potential impact it has on Scotland's brand, that is viewed as very trustworthy for Scots to do business in the world and for the country itself. I wondered what, if you'd managed to give any specific consideration to that, and therefore how you heighten Scotland's brand to permeate through some of the issues around global corruption. And obviously I'm relating to the City of London. Are you able to give any further reflections on that?
Yeah, so this is a big focus. It's identified in the strategy as one of our strengths. It's identified in the strategy as one of the areas of greatest growth. We already know that in Scotland, we have more assets under management that are defined as ethical, for example, compared with our share of the proportional market. So there's already been a disproportionate growth when it comes to that ethical financing piece. And there is a huge opportunity to position Scotland's brand as distinctive from the rest of the UK, largely because we do have a well-known, well-regarded financial services industry here in Scotland, and because on our doorstep we have significant opportunities to connect what our financial services are doing with our natural assets, for example. And I go back to that point around the significant opportunities around our natural assets. We've just launched the Global and Ethical Finance Initiative, and that was launched about a fortnight ago, and launched with none other than Mark Carney. So Mark Carney was the keynote speaker. He shared a panel with me. This is firmly on his radar. He is conscious of the work that we're doing. And we had a lot of interest from across the world in that launch and what we're trying to achieve. So I think initiatives like that do set Scotland apart in terms of what we're trying to do. And of course, what we want to do is build on the legacy of COP26 particularly. So on your question around branding, I think we've set out a plan here through the Global Ethical Finance Initiative. We're working on it, and we are keen to position Scotland as the home of ethical finance.
Thank you. Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, thank you very much for attending this morning with your officials. I will now briefly suspend the meeting while we change over the panel. Item of business this morning is an evidence session with the Scottish National Investment Bank. I welcome Willie Watt, Chair, who is joined by Carolyn Jameson from the Scottish National Investment Bank. And can I also welcome Liz Smith, who has requested to attend this session. As always, can I ask members and witnesses to keep answers short and concise, and I invite Mr Watt to make an opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. I also have a slight problem, which is I can either see all of you or my notes. So while I read my opening statement, I'll concentrate on the notes. Thank you for agreeing to our request to provide evidence to the committee, which I very much appreciate and welcome. Indeed, I hope that this is the first of many interactions with this committee. I'm pleased to be here to speak about the work of the bank and the progress we've made since our launch at the end of November 2020. Carolyn and I will be happy to take questions on the work of the bank. Carolyn has joined me in her capacity as a member of the bank's board and as a member of its Remuneration and Nominations Committee. And at the end of my introductory comments, Carolyn will introduce herself. I'm sure we will touch on many areas today, including our investments and the ongoing work to establish the bank. And in that regard, I thought to set out a short update for the committee. Since the bank's launch in November 2020, we've concluded 13 investments totaling £191 million of committed capital. We have a strong pipeline and are currently considering 50 opportunities which are spread across all of the missions and also a wide geographical area. Those investments speak to all three of the bank's missions and are divided across direct investments in SMEs, project finance, and investments in externally managed funds. Just to recap the missions set by Scottish ministers, supporting Scotland's transition to net zero, our net zero mission, investing to improve opportunities for people and communities, our place mission, and harnessing the future of technology and innovation to build a more resilient, productive economy, our people mission. I'm proud of the progress we've made in developing the bank's investment portfolio, while at the same time building up the operational capacity of the bank. The investments will deliver mission impacts across Scotland and form a strong basis for the bank to operate as a key pillar in the Scottish economy. As well as concluding investments, we have substantially grown our organisational capacity since launch. We're now a fully functioning organisation with capacity and capability in all aspects of our business, one which is well placed to continue the bank's journey as it becomes a key pillar in the Scottish economy and broader civic society. At the point of launch, the bank had a skeleton team predominantly recruited on an interim basis or seconded from the Scottish Government. Over the past 16 months, we've recruited a permanent team which combines both private and public sector expertise. And the total headcount now is 62. We have created a professional investment process in line with development bank and private sector impact investment best practice. In the time since launch, we have been working hard to establish ourselves in the economic and investment ecosystem in Scotland, and we've made significant progress in building relationships across the public and private sector, but there's still much that we can do in both of those areas, and that's maybe something we could come on to later. So moving on to the recent resignation of Ailie McTaggart, I'm fully aware that Ailie's resignation will be of interest to the committee and no doubt will be the process for recruiting her successor. As we outlined in the bank's public statement on the matter, Ailie made the decision to resign from her position as CEO at the bank for personal reasons, and she resigned on the 27th of January. Ailie then made a statement on the 5th of March confirming that she stepped down for personal reasons. The board respected her decision, and we are grateful to Ailie for the contribution she has made to the establishment of the bank. And many of the features that I highlighted in my introduction, Ailey was significantly involved in those achievements. We have not shared further details. As an employer, we respect Ailey's decision and her request for privacy. As you'll be aware, Ailey highlighted in her announcement that she'd like to spend more time with her young family, and she will then go on to consider future opportunities as and when she feels that's appropriate. We have a duty of care to all our employees, past and current, and our policy is not to divulge information on confidential and personal employee matters. This is not just in relation to Ailey. We're entirely respectful of the fact that team members have the right to privacy, and that as an employer, individuals place their trust in us, that we will not and do not comment on issues of personal, confidential or private matters. This is a principle that we take seriously. We've confirmed that Sarah Roughead is now acting as CEO, which will ensure the bank continues to run as usual until the appointment of a permanent successor. Sarah is doing an excellent job, and as our CFO, she was already involved in all aspects of our business. We have a really good team in place, along with robust governance and processes, supported by a strong board. So we believe we are on the front foot going forward. I'll stop there. And before questions, if I can just hand over to Carolyn to introduce herself.
Thanks, Willie. And good morning, everyone. Thank you for having me here. Just by way of introduction, as Willie said, I'm on the board at the National Investment Bank. And as part of that, I also have a role on the REM committee and on the risk committee. And then in my day job, if you like, I'm the chief trust officer at Trustpilot. And prior to that, spent many years on the executive team at Skyscanner, and then post the sale of Skyscanner worked for Ctrip in an M&A capacity as their head of M&A. So that's a little bit of background on me so that you're aware.
Thank you, Ms. Jameson and Mr. Watt, and welcome to the committee this morning. Mr. Watt, as you have said in your statement, there is a recent resignation issue that I'm sure members of the committee, some members, will wish to ask about. I do understand your role as employer, and you've set out clearly the parameters in which you wish to discuss this issue. So could I first ask maybe some questions about timescales? It'd be interesting when you as the chair were notified of the decision of the chief executive to resign, and when the board were informed, and then when the shareholder, which is the Scottish Government, at what stage they were informed.
Well, Ailey resigned to Willie on the 27th of January, and the shareholder were made aware on the 31st of January, which was also the day that the board were made aware of it.
And Mr. Watt, was the chair at the same time as the board, or was that a
I was made aware on the 27th of January.
Okay, that was the chair. I'll now hand over to the deputy convener.
Thank you, convener. Again, just on the question of a new chief executive, are you confident that you'll have a new chief executive in place at the start of the financial year?
No. being totally honest with you, I think that it will take some time to recruit the right person. We will need to make sure that we have a broad funnel to attract a wide range of potential candidates. And then we'll want to go through a very diligent process to make sure we recruit the right person. We've already started that process now, but that will take probably until the second half of this year, potentially the end of the second half of this year, before we have someone in place. That does not overly concern me, because I'm very confident in Sarah's role as acting CEO and the fact that we have a strong team around her.
As a matter of interest, will the recruitment process include the use of headhunters?
We will use external search consultants. That will enable us to broaden the trawl across a much wider range. than just sort of advertising. And also it will allow us to target individuals who might have very specific experience, for example, in other development banks that would be difficult for us to do if we just put an advert up in LinkedIn or something like that.
I suppose arising from that, there's a certain interest in what the cost of the recruitment would be.
Yes. Well, what we will do, what we are doing, is we will identify a set of firms that we feel have the right professional capabilities. As I think everyone in this committee would agree, it's an extremely important role, and we actually have to make the absolute right choice. So we'll select a potential group of search firms that we think have the capability. We will then seek proposals from them, and we will evaluate those proposals on a combination of cost and capability. And certainly value for money will be a very important criteria for that selection.
Thank you. Before I bring in Jamie Hagley-Johnson, can I just ask, because the Chief Executive left with immediate effect, what impact there has been on the bank? Because you seem to suggest that there's been no impact, but it would usually be a post where there would be a handover period and a period of time, or you would know in advance that somebody was about to leave. What has the impact been on the bank with it being an immediate resignation?
Take that. The bank have actually coped remarkably well. Ailey had built a very strong, high-quality team, and they were left to pick up the reins, and they've done so very well. I think as a board, we've been very pleased by what we've seen. And also as a board, we've been providing additional support and spending time in the bank as well.
Okay. Jamie Hagley-Johnson.
Thanks very much. Good morning to you both. And I've got a number of questions all relating to this, and so I'm very happy for one-word answers or can't say. I suppose the first question to you, Mr. Watt, did the Chief Executive's resignation come as a surprise to you?
Yes, I think that it would be true to say that that was the case.
Okay. And was there any efforts by yourself or instructions from the board perhaps to see if there was any way that the Chief Executive could stay on, perhaps looking at circumstances?
I think Ailey resigned for personal reasons, and I think that was the position that the board took, was that she was entirely in our rights to do that, and we respected that decision.
So you were comfortable it was personal reasons? There was nothing in terms of relating to her, the work or relationships with the
board? No, she resigned for personal reasons.
Okay. This again may be an area where you're not able to comment, so I'm comfortable, I suppose, with that. She resigned, you said, on the 27th. Has there been any? Was there any kind of enhanced severance package or anything like that that was made available?
I'll answer that, and the answer is no. Ailey, there was no severance package at all related to this.
And there is no. I'm just trying to think of a kind of non-disclosure agreement or gagging order or anything like that. So she'd be quite available to speak. Okay.
Yeah, there's nothing.
Just kind of moving on a little bit to in terms of, I think you said the Scottish Government were made available on the 31st. How was that done?
A telephone call to the relevant civil servant.
To make them, and was there any inquiry from them or anybody in terms of the nature, or was it simply that the Chief Executive had stepped down? Because obviously this is 4 days later. I'm not sure exactly what days of the week those are. But is
Thursday and Monday.
Right, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And there was no kind of inquiry from the Scottish Government about, the reasons behind it?
We had a conversation and I relayed, the Ailey's reasons to the individual.
Okay. I think the timeline you gave us, the Chief Executive stepped down on the 27th. It wasn't until the 5th of March that a statement was made. Now, obviously, I think your argument would be that this was a personal kind of issue, but that's quite a long time for a kind of formal response to come. Was the bank, or are you aware of whether the Scottish Government or any of its agencies involved in encouraging the Chief Executive to come out with something? Because obviously, both the Cabinet Secretary and the First Minister had made the point that you're making now, that it was personal reasons, but that hadn't officially being said, it was a kind of suggestion that those are the reasons behind it. Why do you know why that statement was made and why it was made so late, and whether there was any encouragement to make that?
There was no encouragement to make that statement, and Ailey had requested privacy. She'd resigned for personal reasons, as we said, and requested some privacy. I think she then got in touch and said that she would make that statement, so I knew in advance, because she was feeling uncomfortable about the scrutiny that she was seeing and the discussions that were taking place. And so she made the decision independently to make that statement.
Okay, so that was her choice to make, and
yes.
She was able to do that.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Can I just ask, obviously, in the kind of conversations that we've gone on, I think we've been touched on the new chief executive. What role will that take in terms of, again, involvement of Scottish Government or Scottish Government agencies, or is that just a matter for yourselves?
It's a matter for the board. The recruitment process and selection is a matter for the board of the bank. The final decision to appoint is a matter for Scottish Ministers. The Cabinet Secretary will have to be happy with the appointment, and our job as a board is to bring the best candidate that we can find for the role to the Cabinet Secretary. So we will be running the process. We will take into account best practice for public bodies in that regard. We will seek to apply the bank's quality and diversity parameters to make sure that, you know, we do that in the right way. But it's a board matter.
It's a board matter. So basically, the final choice of the board will be put before the cabinet secretary.
Yes.
There won't be a number of options.
No, I think we would not be doing our job if we, you know, came up with two or three options. I think it's our job to make a decision, and of course the Cabinet Secretary can decide not to confirm that individual, but I would hope that she would trust our judgment.
You've not had any direction in terms of
none whatsoever,
so it'll be your process and then that person.
Correct.
Okay, I'm conscious of time, so I'll come on.
Thank you. We are starting to repeat some of the questions that were asked by Mr. Beattie. I'll go back to Mr. Beattie here. There's a couple of questions he would like to ask on broader issues.
Yes, moving to something a little less sensitive. I realise these, in terms of investment, these are early days yet to be able to judge the success or failure of the investments. But I'm going to ask you just the same. You indicated you had 191 million invested into 13 projects or companies. How were the opportunities identified, and what selection criteria was used in the decision to invest?
Mm-hmm. The first thing to say, I think, is there was a sort of pent-up demand, because obviously the investment bank hadn't existed previously, and the things that it was doing were different from enterprise agencies and other elements of the public infrastructure. So there's a lot of inbound demand. We are very open to people coming to us with opportunities. We also get referrals from the enterprise agencies. That's an important part of where things come to us from, and the private sector and their advisors, who are seeking to raise project finance or finance for SMEs. Those have been the prime bases for where opportunities have come from. Going forward, we want to make what we call outbound origination more prevalent rather than inbound, and that means taking the missions and then going out and seeking opportunities that we feel fit with those missions. So for example, an area we've identified is the decarbonisation of heat. So it's a massive problem for us in Scotland. It's hugely expensive. It will require a lot of private sector capital. So having said all of that, we need to then start to target projects and companies that we think can contribute to that and go out and engage with them directly. So we want to do more of that in year two of the bank's existence than in year one. In terms of how we assess opportunities, we start with a mission fit. So an opportunity comes to us and we say, does it fit with one of the three missions? Sometimes it fits with all three, sometimes it fits with two, but it has to fit with at least one. So does it fit with the missions? What kind of impacts to the mission objectives will it make? The second criteria is there a commercial investment opportunity here which makes sense for the bank? You know, the bank is not giving out grants. The bank is not making sub-commercial investments. It's making investments where we expect to get our money back and make a positive return, which will go into the bank's coffers for reinvestment. The third element is our state aid compliance. We can't crowd out the private sector. We have no wish to do that. So if the private sector can or should or wants to do something, we will step back. So I like to see it as three rings, where there's the missions, there's commerciality, and there's state aid. And our landing area is in the centre of those three rings. We're in that overlap space. And so every project we do needs to be in that overlap space.
I'm not going to ask you to comment on individual projects or investments that have been made, but looking at the figures I've got here, I can't quite work out how much of the investments are into equity investment into the business and how much is actually a loan. And of course, the intention always was that the bank would provide patient capital.
Yes, and the loan investments tend to be very long term. So they are very much in the patient capital space, and that will continue. We do some lending on what one might call project finance, where there is an element of getting a project off the ground that the private sector won't or can't provide. Some of those loans can be on a shorter term, but our equity investments are all on a long-term basis. So one of the things that we are passionate about is the scaling up of Scottish businesses. And, you know, a lot of work's been done by Scottish Enterprise, the enterprise agencies generally, in terms of the business birth rate and early stage investment. But what we need more of in Scotland is that scaling up of businesses. You know, Carlin's previous company, Skyscanner, was a great example of a business that was a startup that then scaled up to employ hundreds of people and create a huge amount of value for the Scottish economy. So scale up is important, and scale up is a long-term process. So I would envisage us making multiple investments over a period of 3, 5, 10 years in some of these companies as they get bigger. And you know, another issue that this committee will no doubt be concerned about is productivity. And I think scale-up companies make a much bigger impact on productivity because they create more better quality jobs, there's more tax paid, they're more efficient, they have a greater reach within the economy. So that's very much a patient capital thing. So just to finish on your question, the numbers on the loans on project finance tend to be quite big. We put £30 million into helping to complete the new Aberdeen Harbour development. The investments in equity tend to be smaller, between 1 and 15 million, but there's more of them. You know, whereas there are fewer of those big project finance loans.
Let me just ask you one last question, which is about the performance of the investments. Yeah. And obviously, as I said at the outset, it's fairly early days for that. Yeah. But nevertheless, are there any of these investments that you feel are in the early days are not performing? And how are you measuring success?
Yeah.
Is it profitability, jobs, turnover?
Yeah. I think at the moment we feel confident on the performance of all the investments we've made, but you know they are recent, and I guess one would expect that to be the case. I think we won't be doing our job if every investment we make performs, because we need to take higher risks than the private sector. So we will have losses. And some of the projects in which we invest will not work. You know, private sector investment firms have losses. So we will have losses, and we ought to have more losses than the private sector. So there will be, and I know that I'll be coming to this committee to talk about investments that don't work over time. But as we stand at the moment, you know, I'm very comfortable with the positioning of the portfolio. In terms of how we measure success, we measure it across a number of measures that are tailored to a particular investment. So on project finance, is the project on time and on budget is very important. On the missions, we put mission covenants into our investments. So, you know, whether it's net zero or place, or there will be a commitment from the company to do certain things that relate to the missions, not to the commerciality of the investment. And we measure those on a twice yearly basis. And then, of course, jobs created, revenue generated, and profitability are also important measures. So there will be a suite of measures for each company. You know, as the portfolio evolves, we will publish the sum total of all of that in our mission report and in the way that we report on the performance of the portfolio from a financial perspective as well as a mission perspective.
Thank you, Fiona.
Thank you. Fiona Hislop, to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Good morning. You've already talked about the importance of the bank not crowding out private finance, and the role of the bank is to invest where the private sector is failing to provide sufficient finance. So how can the bank be sure that they are investing in a company or a project that wouldn't get private investment anyway? And perhaps you can give us an indication of where you think there's greater appetite from the private sector to invest, and where there's lesser appetite, that is the sort of areas that you might, within your Venn diagram, look to target.
Yeah. We have a subsidy control team that operates separately from the investment team, so that there's no kind of pressure on them. And they look at every opportunity with that lens. We seek written proof from companies that they have tried to raise private finance for this particular component and they haven't been able to achieve that. We also benchmark that with other banks and investment institutions that we think they may have spoken to. So we reference it, essentially, and then we apply the framework of our state aid approval and compare where that company is with the state aid approval framework that you know, came down to us from the European Union before we left. And so there's a separate kind of auditable thread that runs through all of the subsidy control and state aid side of it. So, and we have debates, you know, at our investment committee, you know, and you know, members of our investment team will, you know, do you think, you know, we'll talk about, do you think this is commercial? Do you think there's somebody out there who would do this? So we it's something we talk about a lot. In terms of where are the gaps, it's, I mean, they are. It's an evolving picture, I think in the scale-up space, there is a reasonable amount of capital available at the early stage, in later stages, I think the private sector is certainly capable of financing that scale up. But there's a bit in the middle where there may be a role for the bank. And in technical terms, you know, the scale up capital, there's a thing called Series A. There's startup, there's then Series A, and then there's what's known as Series B. And the gap between Series A and Series B is a place where I can see the bank helping companies to achieve the milestones that they'll then need to be able to raise the next set of capital totally in the private sector. In projects, the private sector will finance most projects without any need for bank capital. What we find is if the project is very innovative or it's in an unproven technology, maybe only 70 or 80% of the financing is available from the private sector. So there's a need for an element of that that we can provide. So we're providing either a foundational that enables the thing to get going. You know, the first £1 million is often the hardest, and so we can provide that. Or the other way to look at it is when most of the investment is available, but there's a gap, we can provide the sort of keystone capital that kind of makes the arch stand up. So it's the kind of piece that holds the other pieces of the investment structure together. So those are some of the areas in which we've found ourselves.
Thank you. And I also want to ask if there's any evidence, I know it's early days, that the bank is attracting domestic and international private investment into Scotland by the sheer existence of a development bank can provide kind of a mission-led, obviously it's attracting interest, but does that give confidence, do you think, from outside investors that there's something interesting going on here that we want to be part of?
I think so, and I think it is early days, but I think I think there are projects that wouldn't have got off the ground without our involvement. And you know, the world of investment is global, and capital is easily moved around. So I think it's important that you know, we highlight the kind of projects that we think are investable. It's really the reason why it's important that we have a professional investment capability, because if we don't have that, then we can't demonstrate a level of professionalism that will then attract in private sector investors. And, you know, I'm often asked about, well, you know, is there too much of an investment focus in your team? You know, does it? But if we don't do that, then we can't crowd in. And the whole reason for the bank is to be a catalyst for the creation of more investment in Scotland, more than the £200 million a year that the Scottish Government has allocated to us. I think what we can do more of in the future, though, is being a kind of champion for Scotland of what is available here. And I think there are good examples of development banks around the world that are very good at that. And when you become more trusted, and we need to earn the right to be trusted. We're just new. People aren't going to just, you know, trust us just because we say, please do that. We need to earn the right. And if we make good investments, and if we demonstrate thoughtfulness and professionalism, then I would like to see us become that kind of trusted partner that will help to bring in external capital.
Thank you, Kavina.
Maggie Chapman, followed by Michelle Thompson.
Thanks very much, Claire, and thank you very much for joining us today and for, at the outset, expressing your willingness to come back to us. I appreciate that, and I know others on the committee would appreciate regular engagement with you, so thank you for that. Just following on from what Fiona and actually some of Colin's points earlier, I'm interested in exploring the sort of challenges that you faced in meeting the strategic objectives, and I also appreciate that it's early days, so there's going to be a limit to exactly the life of some of those projects and challenges. What is it that you need to overcome those challenges? And I suppose linked to that, although it is slightly separate, given the overarching purpose of the bank and very closely linked to those strategic objectives. There are clearly very good examples of sustainable development offered by the bank, but probably all of those projects, some maybe more notably than others, will have negative or could have negative social and or environmental consequences. So do you, in your longer term thinking of the life cycle of a project and the consequences thereafter around sort of circular economy spin-offs or building in the initial aims across the full life term of the project?
Yes, I mean, those are very good points, and they are the right things to think about. Maybe if I start at the end and go back to the beginning. I think we try not to invest in projects where we see disbenefits, if you want to call it that, in relation to the missions. But you know, if you're going to renovate a hotel in the Highlands or pour concrete into a harbour in Aberdeen that is going to be a centre for offshore wind, then in a sense you are having a negative environmental impact. So I guess intellectually it's about the balance between positive and negative impacts, and the balance needs to be skewed dramatically towards the positive. It can't just be a kind of fine balance, because to your point, we wouldn't then be investing to the purpose if that balance is a fine balance. I think we could be better at explaining our thinking in some of the investments we've made, and you know, I think maybe we were a bit naive about the need for the detailed level of explanation that you know might be behind your question. So I think in future you will see a lot more of the detailed thinking being made public about why this investment has been made. And how we went through the thinking across some of those issues. I also think, being honest with you, that we are still learning, and I guess we're all learning, aren't we? Because there are unintended consequences of most types of activity, and that is certainly true. About investment activity, and so we need to make sure that we're being really thoughtful about that. But I think a combination of those things should, and also we need to take part in the debate, and help to shape that debate. So I think that's how I would characterise the second part of your question. In terms of the first part of your question. There are lots of challenges around linking investment activity to the missions in the right way, avoiding the problems of competing with the private sector whilst investing in projects that are viable. And so that's why I think in the future we want to do more of our own origination and be in more of an outreach mode than in a kind of we get so many inquiries that it would be quite easy just to deal with the inquiries that we get. But I think the more thoughtful we can become about how investment can help to solve the problems that underlie the missions, we then need to go out and find things more positively. So that, you know, I think if I was sitting here in a year's time having this conversation, I'd like to be able to give you more evidence of where we've done that. I don't know if that answers your question.
No, that's really helpful, and I think there's actually why I link those two points, because I think there is something around being able to see the connections of potentially some negative or detrimental consequences, but then supporting those who can mitigate those and sort of think of that circular economy in a way which we haven't seen in this kind of strategic investment before. So, yeah, I look forward to your update next year.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Michelle Thompson to be followed by Colin Smith.
Good morning. Thank you very much for attending today. I just wanted to pick up on an earlier point that you referenced, Willie, and then moved on, which was around subsidies. I note that in your submission to this committee, you commented on the UK subsidy control regime and noted that at this point in time, there isn't really any clarity. And having followed it up myself, I understand there are some principles that may ultimately rely on legal challenges leading to precedent, which seems to me a very clumsy way of doing things. What I wanted to check with you was two questions. Have you had any further insights that we might not be aware of? And two, what the impact of this approach may have on your investments?
Mm-hmm. Yes, I mean, it's a very interesting area for us, as you can imagine. And I suppose our approach to it is to say, well, what do we know? And we know what our state aid approvals were within the context of European Union membership. And the principles on which those were founded were sound. We also feel that they allow us to do pretty much everything that we want to do. So I think that is for us foundational. I guess it's not unreasonable that there should be a period of uncertainty around what the UK government state aid position will be ultimately. And I suppose that the government in Westminster left the European Union in part so that it could have more flexibility around things like state aid. So I don't anticipate that the state aid, and I could be completely wrong here, I don't anticipate that the state aid landing zone in a UK context will be more problematic for the bank than the current state aid position. But in this period of uncertainty, we just stick with what we know. And I think that is UK government guidance as well. So I don't think we're doing anything that would be out of the ordinary within a broader context. You know, I think all of us would like, you know, to have more clarity on that. But it's not something that we can directly influence.
Thank you. And just following again, picking up on another thing we touched earlier on, risk relative to innovation, which, of course, is one of your guiding mantras. It almost seems like counterintuitive that in the moment in which state flux of geopolitics, that actually the requirement for more innovation, net zero, of course, as well. It's how confident are you that you've landed it just right in the current climate? Because you yourself have alluded to perhaps if you only ever invested in government bonds, you'd always get a guaranteed return, but you wouldn't, you know. So there is a sweet spot, which I regard as quite challenging given the nature of you, how you're set up and structured, because not everybody necessarily understands how that, what that translates into in terms of risk appetite. And it's not all that common for parliamentarians to understand about risk appetite. So I have you got any further reflections at the moment in the light of geopolitics that...
I think it's a fluid... There's not one answer for a significant amount of time, because risk appetite in the private sector flows in and out. And, you know, there will be periods when there are projects that we might look at where there will be no requirement for the bank to act because that the private sector's risk appetite will be higher. And there will be periods when the private sector's risk appetite is lower, when we will be active in a particular space. But that might last for a few years. And then, so it's a fluid situation. And it's something we think about literally every day. And it's a matter of judgment, and it will need to evolve over time. And we'll need to look at the investments we make and then assess those against that risk appetite framework and decide whether, you know, we've been too conservative or too liberal with our risk budget. But in relation to the geopolitical times, it's interesting that in many respects, the drivers for, I think the missions are quite well thought through. I claim no authorship of the missions, but I think they are well thought through because they speak to fundamental issues in our economy. But they also speak to issues that are highlighted by the geopolitical uncertainty that we've got. The importance of the move to net zero, you know, is highlighted by the volatility in energy prices that, you know, we're currently seeing. You know, that has a knock-on effect on poverty and our place mission, because the poorest in our society are least able to deal with that volatility in energy costs. And the need to have an innovative, vibrant business community that creates jobs is really important. And the digital world and innovative companies tend to be perform best in difficult times. They're more resilient to difficult periods. So I would expect a lot of the digital businesses that we back to continue to drive forward, even despite all of this. So, you know, I think we need to take all of those things into account. But I think what it does overall is underscores the importance of the missions and the need, you know, to make progress on them.
Okay, thank you very much, thank you.
Colin Smith, we're followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Good morning to the panel. On the issue of the role of the bank investing where the private sector is failing to provide sufficient funds, your biggest investment is obviously £50 million in a forestry fund run by asset managers Gresham House, a firm that I have to say admitted owning a management company in Guernsey, which is a well-known tax haven. Now, forestry isn't short of people queuing up to invest, so where did you see that particular market failure that you needed to fill? And I noticed on the Sustainable Forestry Fund website, it highlights that this is going to create rural jobs. So how many jobs has been created so far from that investment?
I mean, I couldn't tell you how many jobs have been created so far. It's very early days for that. I think from memory, you know, there are a number of 200 jobs has been mentioned in the past over a broader period. The market failure there was that you're absolutely right to say that forestry is normally invested in the private sector perfectly capably. The problem with this fund is that it had a much higher percentage of new planting and a higher percentage of native species than historically had been the case. And the investment manager's thesis was that in a period when natural environment regeneration and the planting of trees was becoming more prevalent, there would be demand for a fund that was, the title of the fund kind of explains. I'm just trying to find my notes, but the title of the fund being based on sustainability, they felt was likely to be attractive to investors because of. Because sustainability is very much what we all should be doing. But they could not find a cornerstone investor to get the fund up and running. And without that, there was no way that they could then raise the rest of the money. So the bank's role was to be that cornerstone. And as I was saying earlier on, the first money is often the hardest. There's a bit of a misconception as to where the capital for this fund comes from, though. And most of the fund's capital has come from public sector organisations. The second largest investor in the fund is a local authority pension scheme, whose members are local authority workers across all factors. And the third largest investor in the scheme is a state-run pension scheme. So this is institutional responsible capital that is investing in very long-term basis to create more forested land in the UK and Scotland.
Even since you made that investment, the market has changed significantly. What you now have is a lot of private companies who, if we're being perfectly honest, want to buy up huge swathes of Scotland to plant trees, including native species. It's not about commercial planting, it's about offsetting their carbon footprint. We see what those companies are. So given the fact that the market is changing, what mechanisms do you have in place that says, well, actually, you no longer need to have a role there because actually the private sector, Green Lairds and all sorts of interested organisations are moving in there to buy up land for tree planting. So what mechanisms have you got to say, well, actually, we don't need to be there anymore because there's the private sector filling that gap, rightly or wrongly?
Yeah. Yes, and I think it goes back to Ms. Hislop's question earlier on. You know, we look at every opportunity with regard to whether there's a market failure or not, and we assess each opportunity on its merits. And, you know, it may well be that we don't do another fund like that for the reasons that you mentioned. But what...
You don't have a mechanism that says, well, actually, we don't need to put that money there. Somebody else will fill that gap. Is that not?
No, because at the time when we invested in the fund, there was a gap and we'd identified that gap and we felt it was right to fill it. We very much believe in planting more trees in Scotland. And what I would say here is that the scale of the requirement, if we're to get to net zero by 2045, is huge. It's many, many, many billions of pounds. And that relates to the forestry sector. It relates to the decarbonisation of housing. It relates to the decarbonisation of transport. So the fact that two or three companies have invested in some forestry since we made this investment does not mean that we've got to the end of what's required in terms of tree planting in Scotland. Scotland and the UK has some of the lowest tree cover of any European country. You go to somewhere like France or Switzerland, there's far, far greater forest cover. And we really do need to think about that. And there's a role for the private sector, there's a role for the third sector, and there's a role for the public sector in that. And I think it's all around balance.
Sticking with obviously that key role of achieving a just transition to net zero and that being one of your main missions, the government have a fund to support community and commercial renewable energy projects called the Energy Investment Fund. Is that a fund that you're obviously familiar with?
Yes, we know about that fund, and I think it has a very important role to play.
Important role to play, but the government are ending that fund at the end of the month, which is £13 million a year over the last 10 years. Now, obviously, when that fund was set up, they identified a market failure. In response to a parliamentary question, they actually say one of the reasons they're ending that fund is that there are new investment mechanisms in place through the Scottish National Investment Bank, which supports the government's strategic priorities to achieving our net zero ambition. So given that this £30 million a year fund, which largely goes on community renewables, is being ended in a few weeks' time, what is it the bank are doing to support community renewables?
Well, certainly community renewables would be within the scope of what we could invest in. And we would apply exactly the same metrics as I explained earlier on in terms of does it meet subsidy control? Is there a good opportunity to get our money back? And does it meet with the missions? Now, clearly, it meets with emissions because it is about renewables. We certainly support community-based investing, and we would certainly look at projects. We have a minimum project size of £1 million, and so we need to meet that minimum approach, but there is no reason why we can't look at community-based renewables.
Something you're investing in at the moment, and get, I mean, the concern is that the government have effectively said this fund is ending, and they've landed that on your desk in a few weeks' time. But presumably, you don't have plans to invest £13 million a year in community and commercial renewables over the next year. So there's obviously a gap there.
Well, I mean, I don't know whether there's a gap. I mean, the way that we work, you would need to speak to the government about what it means around this, the cessation of that fund. What we will do is, if people have projects that they want to come and talk to us about, we're very happy to talk to them. And so I don't know whether that means there's 2 million of demand or 20 million of demand in community renewables, but we're certainly open for business with regard to community projects.
Okay, certainly that's an important point. Yep. Yep.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Smith. Gordon MacDonald, to be followed by Alexander Burnett.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning. I wanted to ask you about the bank's mission statement to address innovation. And you already talked about the need to improve productivity. So how does the bank assess investment opportunities in terms of innovation, and what weighting is given to that in terms of how it would improve productivity?
I mean, it's a very good question, in the sense of, essentially, when we think about innovation, we're usually thinking about doing things differently, either in the digital world or in the world of physical products. We're thinking about companies that are sort of breaking the mold, as it were, with regard to technology and software as well as hardware. So part of that is to analyse the feasibility of those businesses. The early stage investment is primarily the home of Scottish Enterprise and the enterprise agencies, but where we're investing at an early stage in innovation, it's really around how practical is what this company doing. I think it's then around the path to revenue growth, and the annualized revenue from an innovative company is seen as an important measure of its viability, more than the profitability, because many of these innovative companies aren't profitable, or they're marginally profitable because they're investing as much as they can in terms of innovation. There's a kind of measure called economic value add, which really kind of tries to transfer, to translate the value of innovation into kind of pounds, shillings and pence. And I think that is quite a good measure, because whilst it's important that we have more early stage companies, if all they do are things that are already done well by existing companies, they're probably not dealing with that productivity gap. The viability of and the growth rate of those companies in terms of product and revenue is really important. And that will be associated with job growth. I mean, I've been in the investment world for nearly 40 years, and in my early days, most people in a company were employed by that company. So most companies did pretty much everything in-house. That's not the case anymore. So when you think about the jobs that are created by an innovative company, there'll be all the jobs in-house, which will grow, but there'll be all these partnership relationships that they have with companies and individuals who are in Scotland and the UK and also more broadly across Europe. We need to think about that ecosystem that surrounds each company. And then I go back to this ability to scale, because we're doing this so that these companies can get bigger and make more of an impact, which is just more of everything. I think we need to figure out how we articulate all of that in the way that we communicate with the outside world. You know, we talked a bit about that with regard to the green space, but there's also the innovation space, and you know, we're talking to people like the Hunter Foundation, and you know, other kind of entrepreneurs that have been thoughtful about this whole space, so that we can help to kind of encapsulate how it works better.
Yeah, you made a comment earlier on about the need to make good investments, and you also talked about the bank's risk appetite. So how do you balance the need to make good investments with innovation and the bank's risk appetite?
I think we need to take more risk than the private sector. And so in every one of these innovation type companies, that there is risk that it won't work, or there's risk that it will get to £1 million of revenue, but it will never get to £10 million. Or there's risk that it does work, but they can't actually produce the thing at scale. So there are all kinds of risks in that. And you know, the private sector does want to invest in these kinds of companies. There's a lot of capital available internationally to do that. So we need to be earlier. We need to be bigger than the private sector might do. That's another way we can take more risk. Or we need to do the bit of the financing that the private sector doesn't want to do. All within the context of state aid and not crowding out somebody else. So it's complicated. And as I said in my introduction, we should be losing money. We'd be nuts to think that, you know, we should be losing a lot of money, because we want the fund to compound so that we can invest more in the future. And we can't do that if the loss rate's too high. But if there's no loss rate, then we're not taking enough risk. So, you know, I think we'll be coming to this committee over the years, and we'll be continuing to debate whether we are actually taking enough risk. And there'll be times when we get criticised because something's gone bust and we're all a shower of idiots. And there'll be other times when we'll be criticised because somebody's saying, hang on, all your investments are successful. You're just doing what the private sector could have done, and you're not taking enough risk. So we've got to get that balance right.
Just a final point on innovation. You said that you've invested £191 million over 13 projects, and it's already been touched upon that forestry is your biggest investment, and your next biggest investment is housing.
Yeah.
Where are the innovative projects within your 13 that you've invested in so far?
Yeah, I mean, what I think we should do, convener, is send the committee a kind of pie chart of where the capital's been invested in terms of the three missions by amount of money and also by number of projects. But generally, we've invested in an innovative Internet of Things company in Glasgow called R3 that uses sensors to measure performance of things like railway tracks and goes up to satellites. We've invested in a smart battery technology that is designed to address this low carbon heat. We've invested in innovative tidal turbines in a company that's selling in Canada and hopefully will soon sell into Indonesia. We've invested in an innovative young business in the Borders that has come up with very kind of circular economy, green insulation materials for buildings. So those would be some. We've invested in one of the world's leading laser technology companies, which was a spin-out from Glasgow University. They say that they produce the world's that's their strap line. The world's purest light. So those are some examples of the innovation.
We do have a couple of speakers left. I would like Liz Smith to have a chance to come in as she's additional to the committee, but I'll take Alexander Burnett first. But if people could be concise in their questions and answers, that would be helpful.
Thank you very much, Camina. Just a couple of questions, and let's hope we don't see you too often regarding individual investments that don't work. But you did mention the sum total. So I'd just like to ask you, do you have a benchmark in the banking sector that you see you measure yourself against in the bank? And at what point do you think it would be reasonable for the Scottish Government to be setting a target rate of return?
That's a very good question. I mean, we're working on that, on both of those things at the moment. As I was saying earlier on, it's a dynamic area in terms of return targets for particular types of investments, but it's a component part into the broader issue of target rate of return. And we're working on a paper for ministers at the moment on target rate of return. It's quite a technical subject, so we're being very thoughtful about that. But we will have recommendations for Scottish ministers by the middle of the year, and we will produce a detailed paper kind of deconstructing what our thinking is on that, which the committee may, you know, I think probably will find interesting. One last point. The actual decision on target rate of return is for ministers. But I think, as we're the technical experts, we ought to try and advise ministers as to what we think is right.
Thank you. We look forward to that paper. In your 21 annual accounts, just over 80% of the bank's assets by value is held in investments with no quoted market price. I just wonder, is that a point in time where that figure is so high? Do you see that going forward as being obviously this all feeds into how difficult it is to measure your return when there's no market for what you hold. I just wonder, is that figure coming down? Is there a target again for around that figure?
I mean, most of our investments will be unlisted because that is where the market failure is. I think in listed markets there's less evidence of any market failure. So I think most of it will be unlisted. But having said that, there are benchmarks for innovation type investments, infrastructure investment returns. So we can benchmark the individual types of return, both in a development bank context and in a private sector context. So those benchmarks should help to guide us in what the ultimate target rate of return should be.
Thank you very much. No more questions, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you. I'd now like to invite Liz Smith, if she would like to ask a question.
Thank you very much, Convener. And Mr. Watt, I know from having met you before that when it comes to very large sums of public money, which obviously is something held by the bank, that you agree wholeheartedly that there should be full accountability and transparency about how that money is spent. And I think particularly in terms of the way that the public is made aware of the objectives of the bank and the direction of policy, that's something you've said both publicly and privately is extremely important. So just as a point of clarity, can I be absolutely clear whether in the last year the board was made aware of any disagreements between the then chief executive and Scottish Government ministers about the direction of policy or the objectives of the bank, and if there were any disagreements, what they were?
There have been no disagreements about policy or the direction of the bank that I'm aware of that are relevant to your question.
Can I ask if there have been any disagreements at all unrelated to policy and the direction of the bank which the board was made aware of in the last year?
No.
Okay. And in terms of whether the board was made aware of any concerns between the former chief executive and Scottish Enterprise, was the board aware of any concerns there?
No, I mean, the chief executive worked with Scottish Enterprise. As you and I talked about earlier, we need to work out how each organisation works together. We're new, that we're the new kid on the block. So we've had lots of discussions to make sure that we're aligned with Scottish Enterprise, but there are no issues that aren't covered by the normal discussions that you'd expect us to have.
So, absolute clarity, there has been no disagreement to the knowledge of the board about any of the operations of the bank and the way of engagement with other stakeholders?
Not that I'm aware of, no.
OK, thank you very much for that. You said in the minutes of when you were speaking to the Enterprise and Skills Board in August 2021, and I quote, that part of the role of SNIB is to solve the lack of private sector investment in certain projects. And you were very interesting in the responses to Fiona Hislop's line of questioning on the same issue. Can I just ask you, since that time, which is obviously seven months ago, have your fears been slightly allayed? Is it becoming more attractive to the private sector in terms of putting their money in?
Just generally to projects in Scotland. This is a matter of degree, and so it's difficult to, take a point in time view of it. I think at the time, investment in low carbon was very much high appetite for the private sector. And I don't think anything that's happened since then has changed that. So where we're going are things that are very early stage or where there's a very specific gap. I think more generally, markets tend to be risk averse during times of heightened geopolitical risk. And I think it is conceivable that there will be a lowering of risk appetite in the private sector because of the events of the last few months. How do we learn about these things? We learn about them from how we experience projects. So I'm not sure we've seen a spike in demand. It's probably too early. So I would have said until this point, there's probably been not much change since what I said in August last year, but that might change now going forward.
Can I just ask on that theme, what do you feel SNIB has to do to be more attractive in helping the private sector to become engaged in?
I think we need to demonstrate that things that the private sector might think are too risky are not as risky as they think. And there was a really good example of this with the Green Investment Bank's investment in offshore wind. And that the Green Investment pioneered offshore wind, and actually now it's all done by the private sector. So I would like us to find areas where we can show that it can be done properly. And then I would ultimately expect us to step back and let the private sector get on with it. That's why we need to operate at the highest professional level as investors, so that we can demonstrate that, so I'd like to find ways in which we could pioneer something in domestic heat. I don't have anything on the stocks that will do that. But if we could pioneer something in domestic heat that could be perceived to be investable by the private sector, that could be a phenomenal win. But we're not there at the moment.
That's very helpful. My final point is, how often does the board meet?
The board has four regular meetings a year. It also has a board offsite, and it meets on an ad hoc basis whenever we decide we need to meet. So, it probably will meet around, 10 times a year or something like that.
That's minuted, is it?
If we have a call That might not be minuted, but normal board meetings are all minuted. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. And just in closing, can I ask about the business plan? When will the this year's business plan be published? And can we expect it to be significantly different from the current business plan, or are we looking at much the same?
The business plan should be published by the before the start of the next financial year. So by the end of March, the plan should be published.
2 weeks.
Yeah. It will not be significantly different, but we'll probably have a bigger emphasis on stakeholder engagement and kind of outward facing. It's time for us to be more outward facing. We've got our internal house in order, so now we should be going out more aggressively into the wider world.
Okay, thank you very much. That brings us to the end of the evidence session. Thank you to both witnesses for speaking to us this morning, and I now move to private session.